Wow.
As in Latin.
Here we go. Welcome, everyone. This is the first year we're learning Parshat Lech Lecha. Let me disabuse you of the first misconception. This isn't a Parsha Shir. A Parsha Shir moves through the cards of each of the Parshat Shavua week to week. That has its utility. Baruch Hashem, my 12th year with the shul, in years 1 through 11, that's what we did. Every year we chose another Parshan, another commentator. We focus on the commentator and try to, as one of my teachers like to say, inject a dye into the system and watch it go through and see, you know, what we could see about a particular approach to a Parsha and to switch each week. This class is, if I'm successful, which is by no means guaranteed, going to be focused on learning Chumash, sort of like the Navi class. In the Navi class that we have Thursday mornings, by the way, come one and all, we're resuming. We had Rabbi Liebtag this past week. We're looking forward a week ago. So this coming week, we'll resume. So there we have to get our bearings first in what's the actual story, and then to try to understand it on a deeper level, and how did Chazal understand it. In a Chumash class, if I'm successful, again, if we're successful, because the first thing is it's a more collaborative effort, we know most of the basic stories. And part of our challenge, therefore, at the outset is to start again from scratch, to see it with fresh eyes, to not bring too many preconceived notions and commentaries that we remember from previous years, but to really to open and to try to study it in depth. I'm hopeful that we will also, through our studies, try to gain some insight into thinking like Parshanei HaMikra. How did the commentators think? What were they start with? Questions. What are the questions that animate them, that begin the process of learning of a given section of the Torah? So here, Parshat Lech Lecha is so familiar to us, not just because of the Parshat Shavu, because how prominently Avram Avinu Sarah Imenu feature for us as Jewish people. The daily tefillot is Baruch Atah Hashem Elokeinu Melech Haolam Avinu Elokei Avram. Oh, we got there, right? And a mention of Avram Avinu on Rosh Hashanah, and Sarah Imenu is Rosh Hashanah, is Yom Kippurim. It's coming up again through the Aseret Yemei Tshuva. So much of a focus on Avram Avinu, Baruch Atah Hashem Magen Avram, I could have said the end of that bracha. So what I'm going to try to do, and it's a challenge of a new sort, is to focus us on a particular section of Tanakh, starting with Parshat Lech Lecha. You can ask me, why didn't I start with Bereishit and Noach? The answer is, to put it in very succinct terms, I am still trying to figure out how to understand Bereishit and Noach. They are incredibly challenged. They really are. And even though we in our communities like it, teach it to children as like the beginning of Torah, so you learn Bereishit and Noach, etc. Truth to tell, in some communities in the Olam HaTorah, they start with like Sefer Vayikra. It's like skip, skip, skip. You'll get the stories because you get the stories. But I always think that part of it is because inside of Parshat Bereishit and Noach, which we read over a two-week period, it's 2,000 plus years of world history is going on, almost 2,000 years is going on in two parshiot. Now the camera speed, l'havdol fe'avdol, slows down. And now we can focus on, okay, here's Avram Avinu, here's Sarah Imenu. Okay, this is the foundation of the Jewish people, and this is our story, and we can order time without these mind-boggling numbers and concepts, frankly, that are very challenging. Also, I know that if we would start with Parshat Bereishit, we wouldn't get out of the first parak or the second parak the whole year. So here we can at least move a little bit. So let's try to do it and see how we go. And I brought, of course, to help us along, just very simple, a photocopy of a page, double-sided, from the beautiful Torat Chaim Chumash of Mosada Rav Kook, which is just some of the basic Parshanei HaMikra. Obviously, the stone Chumash will all hold in hand, but I thought also supplemental to try to see some things in here. We'll see how we go. And also, of course, the atlas.mikra, which I'll pass around in a bit. There's the Hebrew version. There's an English version as well. Excellent. I can't. I'm out of superlatives over the years to describe it because it gives you a flavor. This is approximately where it happened. They don't always know exactly where events transpired. I mean, you know where Israel is, but I'm saying where was this city and this town and this biblical event? But an approximation, it gives you at least some way of holding cup, you could say, about, this happened in a particular location at a particular time. Yeah. So when we open up Parshat Lech Lecha, page 54, we remember, of course, that the Torah is not divided into prakim. The chapter 1, 2, 3, we're at chapter 12, is of no moment. It was imposed upon us essentially from without by other people who did not have our best interest in mind on any level, except to bring us to polemicize with them and have polemical debates. I mention that because on a much more, from friendly sources within Chazal, there is a division of Parshiyot HaShavua, portions of the week. But this also has a certain limitation. And the limitation is on display when you come to the beginning of Parshat Lachta. Imagine, you know, Lahavdil, the children come to their second grade or something, and they get their first Chumashon, so they learn Parshat Lech Lecha first, probably for the same reason we're learning Parshat Lech Lecha first. When you open it up, it doesn't give you very much background at the beginning of the Parsha. Vayomer Hashem el Avram, Lech Lecha, me'artzcha, u'mimladetcha, u'mibeit avicha, el ha'aretz asher ar'eka. We may not get past this pasuk today. So, if you just open Parshat Lech Lecha from the beginning of Lech Lecha, you would say, where's the background? Who is this person? Why is God talking to him? Why is he deserving? In what way is Hashem talking to him? Where is he when Hashem speaks to him? What is he being exactly asked to do? All these questions open up when you just open Parshat Lech Lecha. Now, Chazal ordained that there should be Parshiyot HaShavua, and they split them where they did. But truth to tell, the story of Avraham Avinu doesn't begin here, but starts two pages earlier. So turn back to page 50. And here we have the top of page 50, Pasuk Yud, a genealogy. The genealogy of the family of Shem. Yesterday, our shul was privileged to host our annual, very popular Noach's Teva, Noah's Ark program, with the animals in the parking lot, with the balloon rainbows, with the face paint, all the things that they had on the Teva, of course, the bouncy house, the pizza. Noah had to order more pies. So, one of my kids told me that they overheard two kids talking in line, and one kid said to the other, "My legs are tired from this morning from standing so long in church." And my child, was a small child, was scandalized. How could it be? So I said, "Look, you know, it's an open event, and I guess people from the neighborhood saw it and they wanted to come." But I said, "Come to think of it," and this came as a huge revelation, Noach wasn't Jewish. And the story of Noach and the Teva is actually a universal story about humankind, of which there are three children, Shem, Ham, and Yafet, of which all of humanity is descended of. Now, of course, my daughter was already like, "What, Abba, what are you talking about?" That was like too, you know, I got too cerebral on her. But she got the part about, oh, Noach wasn't actually, she was trying to wrap her head up. What do you mean he wasn't Jewish? Didn't Hashem speak to him? Yes, but Hashem didn't only speak to Jewish people. Adam and Chava weren't Jewish. They weren't Jewish. How can they not be Jewish? They're not Jewish. The whole world isn't, you know, that's where a child realizes the whole world isn't Jewish. No, there's over 7 billion people on planet Earth, and we're 0.2% of the population of the world. Maybe. So here's the genealogy. Here's Shem. Here are all the children of Shem, starting from Shem himself and showing us 10 generations. And one of those generations, of course, we also forget when you read this, it's not just there was one family. Each time it says Vayolad Banu Vano, it means many different other children were born. We're just tracing on the family tree the lineage itself, right? Okay, so now, where is Avram Avinu introduced? There's someone named Nachor and Pasuk Chavdalid. Nachor has a child named Terach. It's his son Terach. Now, Pasuk Chavah, verse 26, Vayichi Terach Shivim Shana, Vayolad Avram et Nachor vet Haran. Here he has three sons, one of them he named after his father, it seems. It says so. Ve'elo toldo Terach. Terach holid et Avram, et Nachor, ve'et Haran. Ve'Haran holid et Lot. Okay, that's germane, because Lot's going to be in our story in Parshat Lech Lecha, so it's Haran's child. Ve'yamad Haran, al pnei Terach aviv, ve'eretz moladato be'ur kasdim. Haran died before his father, on the face of, means in the presence of, perhaps, his father Terach, in the land of his birth, in Ur Kasdim. Whose birth? In the land of whose birth did Haran die? You understand? Haran died in the place of Terach, his father, in the land of his birth. Who Terach was born there? Was Terach born in Ur Kasdim, or was Haran born in Ur Kasdim? It doesn't say. just doesn't say. Vayikach Avram v'Nachor lahem nashim shem eshet Avram Sarai v'shem eshet Nachor Milkah bat Haran avi Milkah va'avi Yiskah. So we have the name Sarai and Milkah, the two wives of Avram and of Nahor, respectively. And it mentions, by the way, that Milkah is the daughter of Haran, and Haran is the father of Milkah and of Yiskah. So if you can keep this straight, Haran, who is Avraham and Nahor's brother, means that Avram and Nahor seem to have married their nieces.
And Lot. I mean, Lot is
And
their
Lot
brother.
Is the third sibling, right. And Lot is the third sibling, right, right. Vatihi Sarai Akara Ein Lavalad just mentions, by the by, that she has no children. Did it mention that Milkah was having children? Doesn't say that Milkah has children here.
It says after the Akedah,
right,
that Avraham hears that,
right,
Milkah had,
right,
children.
Right.
So that leads you to think that somehow they were barren, and maybe that's why the brothers
married
them.
Maybe they were both barren. Maybe that's why they're both barren. My point is, you have to look for the absence. So my question goes back to you. I set a little trap. So why did the Torah wait all the way till then to tell us that Milkah had children then? If she was an Akara, why did it say that she was an Akara here, that she was barren over here? It left it out.
Why does it use Yiskah,
right,
for Sarai?
Right. Why did it say she have another name? Yeah. All good questions, right? So what we keep asking, when you see something in the Chumash, in the Torah, you ask, why is it that way? Could it have been another way? And if there's somewhere else that the same information is being communicated later, why was part of the information deferred until later? Vayikach Terach, by the way, who made the trek from Ur Kasdim toward the land of Canaan?
Terach.
Right? It was not Avram Avinu first. It was Terach. It says so in the end of Parshat Noah. Mm-hmm. But we have this illusion when we come to Parshat Lach Lecha, Shabbos morning, Monday, Thursday, or Shabbos afternoon, we hear beginning Parshat Lach Lecha, it says, Shem told Avram to leave his birthplace, leave where he grew up, etc., and go to the land that he will be shown, which is the land of Canaan. But lo and behold, look at just, it's one page earlier in the Sefer Torah, it's a paragraph earlier, look what it says. Top of the page, verse 31. Pasuk Lamed Aleph, Vayikach Terach, et Avram beno, ve'et Lot ben Haran ben beno, ve'et Sarai kalato, eshet Avram beno, vayetzu itam me'ur kazdim lalechet arzei Canaan. It actually says they were going toward the land of Canaan. Vayavo ad Haran vayesu sam. They got to Haran and they encamped there. That's where they dwelt. Vayu, and then it tells you a little of the lifespan of Terach. Vayu yemei Terach chamesh shanim u'matayim shana vayamot Terach b'Haran. Right? So it just mentions, by the way, he's not going to make the rest of the journey. He stops there. He dies there. He'll be, it tells you that he was 205 years old when he died. Karen, please ask. Go.
Haran then is not in Canaan.
Haran is not in Canaan.
Okay.
Right? They're on the way to Canaan,
right,
but they haven't arrived there.
Right.
Okay. Now, I'll send this around. It's on page 67 over here. Let's see if you can see it. I'm going to move the post-it note in here right to the, so that it will be immediately on top of the word Haran, so that you just have to look right at it. You'll see where Haran actually, we think, is located. And this is the map, presumably, of where Avram Avinu went. They didn't cross through the great desert. There was a path. What's the path? It hugs the river, right? Which river? The Euphrates. Why? Because you need water as you're going. So you walk in the fertile crescent, means, and it's shaded here in green, so you see where people could walk, where they would go. So Haran is going to be all the way up here, whereas Canaan is down here. Let me pass it around, just go send it around, just take a moment to look at it. And I just put the post-it, just careful, you're right near the camera. Yeah, definitely.
Now,
this is the new technology. We're beta, so we're trying to now see if it works.
So the other brother,
yeah,
the other brother does not, Nahor, does not go with them,
right,
from Ur Kasdim,
right,
to, well, we're not sure if we're
Ur, well, we don't know. Ur Kasdim, it's Ur of the Chaldees. Yeah. The Chaldeans lived in the area of the Mesopotamian area, which today would be in the area of Iraq, somewhere in Iraq. We're not entirely sure. And here's where the plot starts to thicken, because you say, wait. I always learned that Hashem told Avraham to go from his birthplace, which seems to be Ur Kasdim, to go to the land of Canaan. Now the Torah spoiled it by telling me that actually his father took him to Haran. By the way, Haran and Haran. Haran is a person. Haran is the place. So what I'm talking now is about the place. They went to Haran. Haran, the brother, had died in Ur Kasdim. It says so. So they go to Haran. So what are they doing in Haran? No, no, they seem to be on a journey in the on the way to Eretz Canaan. So what's going on here? The next, we open Parsha Lecha, Hashem told him to leave his place. This is going to be a discussion among the commentators. You understand? If it was, I thought the whole heroic piece is that Hashem came to Avram one day and told him, the Torah is going to say 75 when it happened. So you're 75 years old, Avram. Please go to the land of Israel. That's where I want you to go. He called it Canaan. That was not called Israel till the Nevi'im. It was not, would not be called that. But it turns out they were already on the way.
Unless they weren't.
But Helen, please.
What is the difference with Rabbi Brent was bringing about Yericho yesterday?
Were you talking Yericho yesterday? That was a special class. Yeah, there's a lot to say.
In the pathway into Israel,
right.
This is a whole different strategy.
Yeah, I can't talk about the nexus between what he talked about and what I talked about because I didn't hear what his exact seer. We did discuss it, by the way, on Shmini Atzeret. We had lunch together, so we were talking all about it. But
the difference of entry.
Right. And this entry point into the land of Canaan is going to be from north moving south. In a cell that you'll see when the map comes around, north to south. But the point is, look where Haran is located. It's on the road, the main highway, from Ur of the Chaldees toward the land of Canaan. It's not a straight line. You have to follow the highway. Right? It's true in any metropolis. It's true intercity as well. So here, that was the way it was.
Where did Nimrod throw Avram in first?
Oh, so that's its own study, which I left out deliberately for today. Sorry. But it's fine. But where did that happen? It happened in, we're almost sure, it happened in Ur Kasdim. That story happened in Ur Kasdim.
So Nimrod was the king.
Nimrod seems to have been the king of the whole area. The whole region. He's the chieftain, not Canaan, but he's the king of the whole region, and he's the chieftain in that area. Now, I'm leaving Nimrod out today, and I'm leaving out the whole story, which many of us know that it's not written in the Torah. The story of the fiery furnace. The Avraham was thrown into a fiery furnace. There's a medrash that describes this happening, involving Nimrod with the test of faith, and he gets thrown in. In fact, the anchor in the Torah is that Haran died in the presence of his father. And many of the Mefarshim will ask, and we'll have to leave this for another time. I want to start first today with a direct, plain understanding of what's going on. That actually Terach took Avram, his son, Lot, his grandson, right, and Sarai, and they all went to Ur Kasdim. From Ur Kasdim, excuse me, to Eretz Canaan, it says. But they stopped in Haran, they just stayed there. So where's Avraham Avinu when Hashem says to him, okay, go? That's the question.
A lot of times, as we already saw today in Torah, they use pronouns, and these pronouns just confuse us. You don't know who the he is. You don't know who the they is.
Right. Let's say they're not there to confuse us, but they're actually there as indeterminate and ambiguous in order to open various pathways of understanding of the same thing.
Is that what's happening here? Because we start with names and then we move to theys.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. And what we're gonna see a couple of examples of that right now. Okay, everyone got to see. Yeah, the map?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now a methodological point before we move even one step forward, just to understand. And I just had a question about this on Shabbos, something in Parsha Noach. We won't go back into it now, but the Torah is obviously written as a book, and it's written as a story with a beginning and a middle and an end. The beginning is the creation. The end is the Jewish people on the border going into the land of Canaan. That's obvious. But you've heard the expression before. We've talked about it many times. Chazal declare, Ein mukdam u'muchar b'Torah. There's no earlier and later in the Torah. They don't mean that first the Jews came to the border of the land of Canaan, then God made the world. That's not what it means. However, what it means, and you've all had this experience if you've read Lahavdil, to separate between the Kodesh and the Chol, the sacred and the profane. If you read any book do you know what is the backstory of something that transpired in the previous chapter? Or we had to finish the story whose title had a name on it, the chapter heading. Now we finished that chapter, and now we open the new chapter. The title on the chapter is organized around a theme. Chronology is not the most important thing that happens here, but rather the theme, the thematic organization is more important. Everyone knows this, happens all the time. The Torah, in that regard, as Chazal themselves declare, Dibra Torah Klashon B'nei Adam, the Torah is written in human language. That in and of itself requires its own study and unpacking, but the basic meaning of it is exactly as the words say, It's written in human language, and there's no earlier and later in the Torah. So let me give you, here's, will be an example. It mentions right here in Parshat Noach on page 52, the last pasuk, the number of years of the life of Terach. And then it describes that he died in Haran. Now, what's going to happen in Avraham Avinu's life moving forward in Parshat Lech Lecha and Vayera, etc., Terach's still going to be alive. But the Torah is not going to interrupt the story later on the chapters whose title is Avraham Avinu Sara Imenu, by reminding us again about a detail about Terach. To take Shelley's example, when after the Akedah, then we'll wake up and then we'll hear, oh, by the way, Avraham Avinu now heard the news. He got the, he finally got word that up in that area where he used to live, in the vicinity of Haran, his brother, Nahor, is married to Milcah. By the way, they have children. Doesn't mean that at that moment they conceived children and they had all these babies. It means he learned that they had children previously, Kfar Kodem. And in that list, buried in that list, is, of course, the name of things we're going to learn about the pairing of Yitzchak and Rivka. Yeah? That's just an example. Now germane to our example. When you open Parshat Lech Lecha, it doesn't tell you the time when Hashem gave this command to Avraham Avinu. It's ambiguous. It doesn't say. Just tells you that Hashem told Avraham, so go from your land and your birthplace and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I'll bless you. These are beautiful brothers. We'll come back to them to see them in depth. Not today. Whoever curses you, whoever blesses you will be blessed, whoever curses you will be blessed, and all the nations of the world will use you as their bracha. Now, Pasuk Dalet, back to the action of what happens. Vayelech Avram, kasher diberi lav Hashem, vayelech itolot, v'Avram ben chamesh shanim v'shivim shana b'tzeito mecharan. It says, he's 75 when he left Haran. Avraham went with Lot. Lot came along with him. It describes Vayikach Avram et Sarai Ishto v'et Lot ben Achiv v'et kol rechusham asher achashu v'et hanefesh asher asu v'charan. Also, all the souls that they made in Haran. Vayetzu lalechet Arza Kenan. They left to go toward the land of Kenan. Vayavo Arza Kenan. They came to the land of Kenan. Well, that was what they did. Then he's already in the land. It'll describe what's happening to the land. So we've had, how many times did it mention Haran now? Twice. It said he lifted himself up from Haran. They got up from Haran, and all of the souls that they made in Haran. Okay? Mm-hmm. You understand the problematic, the issue? And if you just follow the story, so he was in Haran, and Hashem came to him, and he told him, so leave Haran and go, which begs the question, so how come Terach started moving toward Canaan?
Yeah, they could have even mentioned in verse 1,
yeah.
Canaan.
Right.
Says, go to the land.
That I will show you.
Yeah.
Right. And it turns out it is Canaan. When he gets there, he finds out, oh, that's... Helen, please.
There's songs in Ladino where they praise Terach. You might think because he's the father of the home, but how do we see Terach now? The Empress measures that he had idols and he was an evil guy. But now, if he's traveling with his son, what do we think of Terach now?
Excellent point.
He doesn't seem to be evil except until Yehoshua. You know, when you know your forebearer is an idol worshiper, and then that's
I know exactly what you're talking about. Can I push back on one word?
Sure.
Evil. Meaning, is Terach evil because Terach grew up in a society where this is what people know? Now, of course, there is the small inconvenient detail that he did take his son to be thrown in the fiery furnace by Nimrod, so that's not so great. But is it, let me say it differently.
But that's a metric.
But wait, but is it possible that Terach did tshuva? Is it possible that Terach at long last realized my son is right? Now he doesn't make the journey to Canaan, so that part he doesn't do. But is it possible that Terach himself does do tshuva at the end of his life somehow? Are there any indications of that? I know it's maybe unfair to say, but please let's bookmark that. We're going to come back to that later. We will see that there are various Mefarshi HaMikra who maintain that indeed Terach did do tshuva. It wasn't the tshuva that also meant he was going to be coming to the land of Canaan and getting a share of the land, but maybe, some say, And he did tshuva, and in the end realized that his idolatrous ways were misguided, were wrongheaded, and had an element from a moral perspective of evil to them, but that he cast all of that away. We'll come back to it.
So the question,
but you know, there's a question. The question about that, you know, how that works.
Why did Terah stop on his journey at Haran?
Right.
Settle there. That's
right.
The key question.
That is a question. Or you could say it differently. What?
Why did he start?
Okay.
I mean, where is Avraham? The question starts with, okay, where is Avraham Avinu when Hashem tells him, I want you to go to the land of Canaan? Like, where is he physically located when this happens? Hashem comes to him and he talks to him and, huh? He's in Haran. Seems pretty obvious, right? Oh, so that's a bit of a problem, don't you think? Right, he's not born in Haran. So if he's not born in Haran, so how does he call it his birthplace? It says leave your birthplace. So wasn't Avraham Avinu born in Ur Kasdim? And that turns back on page 50. Look at page 50. What does Pasuk Chaf Chet mean? What does that verse mean? In other words, to say it differently, in verse 26, it tells you three boys who were born, three sons to Terah, Avram, Nahor, and Haran. They're not triplets. Let's say they're born 3 years apart. Could be much more, but they're born. There's an age. There's some kind of ordering of ages here, right? And if you want further proof, look at Pasuk Chaf Zayin, the next one. Here's a toldot of Terah. We have Avram, Nahor, Haran. They're organized there as well. Mm-hmm. Now, Haran has to be old enough to have a child because Haran already has a son named Lot when another story happens, which is in Pasuk Chaf Chet. And now I want to ask you again, what is Be'eretz Moladeto? Who is in Eretz Moladeto when it says in the land of his birth? Haran died in the presence of his father, Terah, in the land of his birth. What is his, or who is the his in that sentence?
It's not the geographic.
Hold on. But answer the question. Let's go to that this question first. Understand? Okay. Understand my question? Ur Kasdim, but whose native land? Who was born in Ur Kasdim? Haran? Terah? Does it say that Avraham Avinu was born in Ur Kasdim over here? Explicitly, it doesn't say. We imagine if Terah, if his birthplace is Ur Kasdim. So obviously Avraham Avinu was born in Ur Kasdim. That's the family land. And something else prompted them to leave after Haran died. They had to leave and go to the land of Haran to live there instead. But they're clearly from Ur Kasdim. Or maybe Eretz Moladeto means Haran was born there or Terah was born there. But maybe they moved around. Maybe they weren't stuck always living in one place. Maybe they lived somewhere else, either before or after. Maybe they went place to place. Maybe they were known to be nomadic type people who moved around in the ancient Near East. So here they lived in Ur Kasdim, then they moved to Haran, then they moved back to Ur Kasdim. Or maybe they started in Haran, then they moved to Ur Kasdim, then they moved back to Haran. Now you ask me, well, what would prompt them to do that? I don't know. Why does the Torah have to tell you all the information? The wandering Jew. They're not even Jewish. They're pre-Jewish. They're getting in wholesale that you can move around a lot before. Yeah. And were they exiled? What? We don't know what prompted.
Natural disasters. There was quite a lot of my.
Maybe natural, my disasters. I'm handing this out. You need this page face up. So just, it's a double-sided sheet. One page. This is from the Torah Chaim Chumash. One page. You giving up?
Don't.
Okay.
Don't you think
I'm translating it all. Don't worry. We're not reading everything on the page. Just wanted you to see. Wow, there's a lot of stuff here.
Don't you think after being thrown in the furnace, he's got to get out of there?
Again, based on that medrash, it sounds like he has to get out of there. Right. He's got to get out of Dodge because he's in a lot of trouble because he came out of the fiery furnace and maybe there's a reason they have to leave. And that medrash explains it very beautifully, which again will beg the question, then why isn't that medrash just in the Torah Shebichtav, right? In his Hakdama to the Torah, the Ramban reminds us that the Torah Sheba'al Peh, the oral Torah, is no less the Torah than the written Torah. And that in point of fact, the Torah Sheba'al Peh, the oral Torah, preceded the Torah Shebichtav, the written Torah. Right? The events happened. The stories were told. Moshe even learns them on Har Sinai. Then he writes it. He doesn't write the story before it happened or contemporaneous to it happening. Not all. Some of it later on, perhaps, you know, in the Midbar itself. But the point is, A lot of us get stuck. Well, it doesn't say in the Torah that the marriage happened. Oh, so maybe it didn't happen. I don't know. But hold on.
Question of why it's not.
I know. I'm just sharpening the question. So you'll come back next week, because next week that's what I want to focus on more. Now I'm just dealing. First, we're talking geography. Then we got to get down to causes. But I'm trying to set the stage right. So if it was so important, so put it in the Torah. Should be a top. Something so foundational, so important as the story of Avram with the idols and the fiery furnace, and you know, maybe it'll give us insight into why they had to run away. These are mysterious things when you just look in the level of pshat. For some reason that we do not yet understand, maybe we will by the end of next week, Shem wanted the Torah not to include that story. Okay, well, why not? Come back next week for that. But let's stick with geography for the rest of today. I'm looking with you on this page. This first page I gave says Kuf Nun in the corner, the Torah Chaim Chumash. And we note that in fact, among the Mefarshei HaMikra, it's just interesting that some of the Mefarshei HaMikra have different things that interest them. So, case in point, Rashi doesn't start with geographic questions. He starts really just with trying to understand the words. So if you look with me, Rashi, it's right in a piece here. Rashi explains here, the top left-hand corner, you see it on your Chumash in the other script, but Lech lecha lahanatcha l'tovat gadol, kan yatazoch l'banim. There you will be a great nation. Here you're not going to merit having children. Ve'od, and further, she'odia tivacha ba'olam, and further that I will make known your character, your nature in the world, there and not here. I'm skipping it. We're just doing it in the most superficial manner. We're going to have to come back to it after the fact. Meaning we'll try to explain it a little bit more in depth, if you will. Okay? So now, look with me at the Ramban. At the Ramban. Oh, I'm sorry. I skipped. Sorry. Stay on this page. Kuf Nun. Let's do Ibn Ezra. See Ra'ava, Reish, Aleph, Bet, Ayin. It's Ibn Ezra. Benu Avram, Ben Moshe, Ibn Ezra. And unlike Rashi, who wants to know, okay, what are the words lech lecha mean? Go to yourself, go for yourself, it'll be good for you. The Ibn Ezra wants to know, where is Avraham located? And so the Ibn Ezra writes, Hashem tzivala Avraham ve'odenu be'ur kasdim, sheyazov artso umakom olarato gam beit aviv. Avram is in Ur Kasdim, his birthplace. And God is telling him to abandon his land in the place where he was born, in the house of his father. V'atam, and the reason for this is, Shiyadah Hashem, Sheterach achar sheyetzeh lalechet al Eretz Kenan, yeshev becharan. The reason for this is that God had the foreknowledge. He knew that Terach will leave the land of Kasdim to go toward the land of Canaan, but he knew that Terach would not make the full journey. Terach would stop in the land of Haran. V'terach lo meit ad achar shishim shana sheyatza Avram mibeit aviv miharan. 60 more years would elapse from the time that Avraham last shook his father's hand or embraced him or waved or whatever it was until he would die. He was 205 when he died, and Avraham is 75 when he leaves. He could do the math. Rak hakatuv lo pirei shana b'tzeitumi or kasdim. But the Torah did not tell us how old Terach was when he left Ur Kasdim on the way to Canaan. We just don't know how old Terach was. V'achar she'amar asher eka gila lo hasof. After he told him the land that I will show you, then he revealed to Avraham the secret. Kichen katuv v'yitzu alechet artza Canaan. And that's why it says they went to go on the way to the land of Canaan. O yihitam ar eka hu she'amar lo ki el ha'aretz asher ata ro'eh l'chat nena. Or our echo that I will show you means when he got to the land, then Hashem told him, oh, you've arrived in the land. Now, Ibn Ezra just said two things here, and I want you to understand what's going on. According to Ibn Ezra, Avraham Avinu was born in Ur Kasdim, the family lives in Ur Kasdim, Haran dies in Ur Kasdim, and in Ur Kasdim, Hashem said this to Avraham. And you know what Avraham did after that? He woke up his father and he said, Dad, I have this vision. We have to go to the land of Canaan. Says the Ibn Ezra, at least one of his interpretations, that's what's happening on page, what is it, page 52, verse 31, top of page 52. And I want you to understand why. What's going on? What's the title on page 50, 52? The genealogy of the family of Shem. It's a family tree. And therefore, the theme is parent-child, 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 going all the way down so we could get to Avram Avinu. Says the Ibn Ezra, at least one of the interpretations here, you know what it means? Asher, the land that I will show you. One interpretation is he waited till Avram got to the land and Avram didn't know where he was going. And when he got there, Hashem said to him, ah, this is it. But the other interpretation of Ibn Ezra is after Hashem spoke to Avram and he told him the land that I will show you, he told him, here's where I want you to go. Now, go convince your family they should come with you. But you're not the head of the family, because when your father's alive, certainly in those days, if not today, but certainly then, he's the head of the family, he's the head of the tribe, he's the head of the clan. So therefore, the Torah pays Terach the honorific. That Terach took Avram, his son, and because he was the son who was subservient to his father. It mentions Avram Beno. Didn't we know that Avram is his son? It said that he was the father over here. So why don't you say, Vayikach Terach et Avram? Why didn't he kach Terach Avram Beno, his son Avram? Because Avram was subservient to his father. He said to him, Abba, we should really go to the land of Canaan. Why should we go there? It's a good place. How come? So did Avram say to his father, Hashem told me? And Terach said, ah. Or he said, Hashem told me. And Terach said, really? I'd have to go. I saw how you were saved. You know, again, you want to go with that midrashic line. I saw how you were saved, my miracle child. And if now you're having visions and Hashem is appearing to you and there is a God, and of course I'm a spiritual man, I believe in God, small g, all these years of my life. So why can't I now wrap my head around the idea there's one God and he's not physical, he doesn't have bodily form and he's unique and he spoke to you? Let's at least start the journey together. I'm a little older though. So it says Terach, I don't know if I'm going to make the whole journey, my child, but come, you and me together. Two believers now in the one God, and I might not be so religious and devout like you, my son, Avraham. I may make the whole journey. Let's go part of the way together. Let's start going. They go to Haran. It's a lovely place. They set up shop. You know, they buy a house. They have a little whatever it is, a little business they open. Terach says, go. I'm not going the rest of the way. You understand what Ibn Ezra just did here? Ibn Ezra said, you know when Lech Lecha happened? It happened right there. Why did the Torah tell you over here that it happened? Very simple, because the theme on this page is the theme of this is Terah, Shem's genealogy. We did Cham and we did Yafet earlier. Here's Shem's genealogy. And by the way, we're going to focus now on Avram Avinu. P.S. If it would have been that Hashem talked to Avram Avinu and it would have described that Avram's running into his father's tent and waking him up, Abba, Abba, let's go to Canaan, and then Terah doesn't go, it's a pretty big failure. Like this, who took the initiative? Terach took the initiative, started going to Canaan. And Ibn Ezra here, in one stroke, at least in this interpretation, explains why is Terach interested in going to Canaan? The answer is not because of bad things, but because he's animated by a vision that Hashem has appeared to his son and told his son, this is what has to be. But he says, I'm not going that part of the distance. By the way, who did go with them? Lot. Who else went with them? Sarai. And who else? All the people whose names we do not know, all the souls they made in Haran. Some came, some didn't. He could convince them. He couldn't convince his own father. Maybe his father's too old. Maybe we don't know what the reason is.
But did both the money that he's taking from Haran into Canaan and the people that he's convinced?
Yes.
They seem to be from his couple of years in Haran and not from Ur Kasdim. He didn't have any, he seemed to have that money before or those people before. So somehow he made all of that in
Haran.
In Haran.
Right.
And maybe it's just too comfortable for Terach to leave.
I say again, maybe. I say maybe.
He opened up a store.
Okay. Yeah. You've given us this way of looking at it. What do you think of it? Because it seems a little forced, doesn't it?
Okay, well, it's not, before we get to me, why don't we go to the Ramban?
Okay.
Because the Ramban writes about his colleague, who he never met in person, of course, but he had great esteem for him, but he writes, I have tochacha geluya va'ava mesuteret. I'm going to have an open rebuke of Ibn Ezra often in my commentary, but I have a hidden love for him. Sometimes it seems very, very hidden, as you'll see in some examples when we start learning. So look with me at Ramban. That's on this column over here, the right-hand side. And I'm starting not at the very top, but I'm starting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 lines in from the top, where it's the words, me'aretzcha mimuladetcha, in bold. So that's right over here. See it? Katav Rashi, and we didn't see this Rashi inside, but Ramban also is a bit of an anthology, tells you, this is a Rashi from further along. Rashi will tell us soon, he writes, V'alo kvar yatsa misham im aviv ve'uva ad haran. Ela kach amar lo HaKadosh Baruch Hu drachek od mbeit avicha. Rashi himself points out, wait a minute, when Hashem said to Avraham, leave your land and your birthplace, Rashi says, well, really, we all know that Avram had already left his birthplace of Ur Kasdim and he had gone toward Haran, but what the command really was, go farther away from your father's house. Rabbi Avraham, next line, the beginning of the line is Rabbi Avraham. You see it right there? Yes. Rabbi Avraham Piresh. You see it right there? Rabbi Avraham Piresh. Rabbi Avraham means Avraham, Rabbeinu Avraham, Ben Moshe Ibn Ezra. He explained, Ukvar Amar Hashem El Avraham Lechem Arzacha. No, Hashem really told him this in Ur Kasdim. That's where he got the original commandment in Ur Kasdim. It's just repeating what Ibn Ezra said. And what does Ramban say? Ve'enenu nachon. Ibn Ezra, wrong. You're wrong. You're incorrect. He doesn't pull any punches. I'm never going to talk that way about a Rishon. But the Ramban was the Ramban. Yeah. So that's what he wrote. He was a Rishon also. If this was really accurate, that really this whole thing happened at Ur Kasdim, that he got the commandment and the invitation to go, etc. Haya Avram, Ikar and Siyami Beit Avim Mitzvat Elokim. Then it should have really said in the Torah in the end of Parshat Noah, Avram got up from Ur Kasdim. Avram left on the way to Eretz Knan. Didn't say that. V'terach Aviv Baratzon Nafsho Elochimo. And why did Terach go? He wanted to accompany his son on his odyssey, on his journey. Right? So he came with him, Vakatuv Amar, but the scripture Davka says specifically, Vayikach Terach et Avram Beno. Avram was taken by his father. Yoreki Avram, Achare Aviv, Vatzato, Yatzam Ur Kasdim, Lechet Atzaknan. We see clearly in the Torah testifies, Avram was following his father's initiative. Ve'ot, Ki Akatuv Sha'amar, Vayikach et Avichem et Avraham, Me'ever Hanar, Vayalechoto, Bechol Eretz Kanan, the aforementioned Psukim that Shelley quoted for us before from the book of Yahushua. That God says, I took Abraham from the other side of the river. It didn't say I took him from Ur Kasdim. It said I took him from the other side of the river. It doesn't say which river. Because there, in that place, was he commanded about this. Where there? Somewhere over a river. But not Ur Kasdim. Would have said it. Another question about these people, Rashi and Ibn Ezra's idea that he was in Ur Kasdim. Ki Avram et Savato et Eliezer lekachet isha livno, amar lo, ki el artzi ve'el mo'ad teleich. Ramban says, what does Avram say to his servant? Go find a wife from my birthplace and from the land that I come from. And where did his servant Eliezer go? To Haran, not to Ur Kasdim. So he says, well, Avram himself testified he wasn't born in Ur Kasdim. V'hu alach el Aram Naharaim el Ir Nahor, to the place where Nahor lives, which is Aram Naharaim is the suburb area of the specific village of Haran in Cain. He artso umladato. That's therefore his land and his birthplace. V'sham ne'amar, there it said, imlo el beit avi telech el mishpachti, go to my father's house and my family. Couldn't be clearer than that. Kisham beit avi mishpachto shehim uladato. Lo kasher hishtabesh Rabbi Avram, not like the mess that was made by Rabbi Avraham in his commentary saying that it's Ur Kasdim, it's fighting words. Lomar elatzi Haran, umorati Ur Kasdim, that Ibn Ezra was falling all over himself to say, to my land is Haran, and my birthplace is Ur Kasdim. Vihine hua umer kan, ki be Ur Kasdim ne'amar lo, lech lecha me'atzim ladan chami beit avicha, vihine la aratzot rabot. So it, actually, you know, he has a lot of lands that he lives in. He's from Haran, he's from Ur Kasdim. And here is what the Ramban theorizes, contra Rashi, contra Ibn Ezra. Avaliikar kvar yadata otomi mashika tavnu b'seder l'shlifneze. I explained this to you in Parshat Noah. Sorry that we skipped. We're going to see it next week, though. That Avraham was given the commandment, leave your birthplace and your land and your father's house. V'kach am Breishit Rabba. That is exactly what it says in Breishit Rabba. Lech lecha is achat me'aram Naharaim v'achat me'aram Nahor. From the two suburbs of Haran, Aram Naharaim, Aram Nahor. And then he goes on to explain why you have to leave this place, why in this staggered manner or graduated manner. It's hard for a person to leave the land that they dwell in. Their beloved ones, their friends. That's where he was born. And his whole father's family lives there. The whole clan is there. Therefore, Hashem said to him, leave Haran, which is where you were born, which is where your family is, which is where your friends are. Leave all of that behind. Of course, you have to ask. We won't have time to read the rest of the today, but we have to ask the question fairly. Okay, didn't it say before that someone was born in Ur Kasdim? Yeah, sure it did. Who was born in Ur Kasdim? Either Terach was originally born in Ur Kasdim and moved to Haran, or maybe Haran was somehow born in Ur Kasdim. For some reason, mysterious reason, according to the Ramban, the name of the city in antiquity, when he was living, which was the 13th century, the place Haran was called Kuta. Chavav Tav Aleph, like the Kutians. That is the place, which is we call Haran. That's the place of the birth of Avram Avinu. The family at some point, let's say, maybe for now, for business reasons, we'll see what those business reasons might have been when we come next week, to Ur Kasdim. Events transpired in Ur Kasdim. There, perhaps, Haran was born. There, Haran died, according to the Medrash, under particular circumstances. Then the family left and went to Haran. You know why they went to Haran? They went back home. And when they got to Haran, they lived in Haran. How long? Years, maybe decades. And then one day Hashem came to Avram Avinu and said to him, okay, now it's time. Now I want you to get out of here. I want you to leave this place. It says they went to Haran from Ur, it says they went to Haran from Ur Kasdim, La Lechet Arza Kenan. So what would Ramban say to that? It's the road. It's like when you get on the road to, I don't know, I'm just giving an example. You get on the road of the 94 leaving toward Indiana, and what does the sign say? New Jersey. I might be going as far as New Jersey. I'm just going to drive on this road till Ohio. I'm going to get off there. Pennsylvania. I'm not going to Pennsylvania. I'm going to Ohio. So Lalechet Eretz Canaan. It's the road to Eretz Canaan. They weren't going as far as that. They were going where? The road to Eretz Canaan, because that's the terminus of the road in a certain way. It's the next big area of transit, right? You're going around. We just saw that on the map. Stop off in Haran. Why stop off? They didn't stop off. They lived there because that's where they were originally from. It's so comfortable here. We have to keep schlepping. We're going to Eretz Canaan. We'll stop here. And then Hashem came to Avram and said, okay, now I have a mitzvah. I want you to go dafka to this place that actually your father happened to mention is the place that he was setting out for, or that was the name of the road, or whatever it is. So what's the answer? Who's right? Take your pick. Maybe Rashi and Ibn Ezra are right. Maybe Ramban is right. Next week, we'll have to understand that Medrash more in depth. We'll actually learn the Medrash, and we'll also see a little bit more about, okay, how that Medrash might inform that we're Kasdim, Haran, Eretz Canaan piece, and we'll take it from there. Ad kan for today in our first foray into a Parshat Lecha. See you, God willing, next week. Okay, thank you.